Hi. This autumn, I was taking a course at this KTH, the Swedish, was it Royal Institute of Technology? I think it stands in English. The ethical hacking course, it's worth 7.5 credits in the European system, which in the previous Swedish system was 5 högskolepoäng. So let's first ask ourselves, I'm just going to say that this will be a very short summary of the course. And the slides I've prepared are just a small amount of the actual course. So if you think this is an interesting subject, I recommend that you actually take the course. It's not free, but it's affordable. I took it through my company, and that costs a little more, but if you're a student, it's not so expensive. These words will be good to have when I'm going through the example in a few minutes. A malicious actor, that's the attacker or the adversary. Or in popular science text, you might find words like cybervillain or hacker. And if there's a war game exercise, it's a cyber exercise, you might be divided into a red team and a blue team. The red team will attack the system and the blue team will defend the system. And then there is maybe a yellow team that is judged, that keeps track of the scores, and after the competition, we compare the scores and see who won. A malware, that's two words, malicious and software, and short malware. Phishing, that's an email with malware attached. And when you click on the malware, on the evil link in the mail, you are infected. Spear phishing, that is a targeted phishing attempt. So that's a phishing mail, but sent only to a few email addresses. So maybe the attackers are attacking a specific plant. Then they first use open source intelligence, or OSINT in short, to find the email addresses of people who work there. Maybe I can try to find some. So here are some links to some OSINT tools which you can use. I think there is a specific one to just from LinkedIn harvest emails and usernames. Yeah, so there are a lot of tools, and finding the email addresses to send mail to, that's the smallest problem if you use these tools. Let's go back to full screen. A virus, maybe you've heard of the coronavirus. Well, a software virus. The coronavirus spreads from person to person, while the coronavirus spreads... No, the software virus spreads from computer to computer. A Trojan, that is a malware that does maybe look like a normal software, but it does more than you expect. So in Greek mythology, there was this free city of Troy that was not under Greek control, and it had a wall around it, so the Greeks couldn't penetrate the wall. That was like a perimeter defense, in if you talk software. And the Greeks used some tricks, some cunning, a ploy. I don't know what's the correct word here. But they built this famous Trojan horse, a wooden horse that they sent as a gift to the Trojans, but inside soldiers were hidden. So the horse was carried or rolled through the perimeter defense, and once inside, the soldiers jumped out and opened the port, so the rest of the soldiers could come in. A rat, that's a remote access Trojan that once installed, typically connects back out to the attacker, and then the attacker has a connection to the inside. A dropper, that's not a malware in itself, it's just a minimal software that when activated connects to the internet and downloads a payload. So this payload can be then in turn can be a malware, for instance a rat. So a small minimal dropper has a bigger chance of going through the antivirus checks in the email software. Enum, that is short for enumeration, so that is what the attacker does once inside the office network. Collects which IP addresses answers to ping. For each IP address, sees which services are on there, which ports are open. And for each service, determine if any of the services have any known vulnerabilities. Credentials, that are things like usernames and passwords that are used to log in or authenticate with a fancier name. But it can also be things like password hashes, which can be cracked using tools like John the Ripper, or tokens or tickets that are given once logged in as a proof of authentication. But an attacker can also try to extract these things and use them to act as that authenticated user. DC, or domain controller, that is the most important server in an Active Directory Windows network. The domain controller is the place where the credentials are stored. If there's just one Active Directory server in a small office network, the domain controller can be the same physical server. So but in a larger network, they might be different. Or they might be more than one domain. So then each domain has a separate domain controller. An HMI, that's in a control system, and that's a graphical user interface to a control system. And if you wonder what a control system is, that is something that are used in, you know, real plants and stuff that controls physical things like valves, pumps, and read pressure sensors, temperature sensors, and things like that. And as you can imagine, there is usually some kind of logic. For instance, if the pressure goes over this limit, open this valve. So that kind of logic is typically in something called a PLC, a programmable logic controller, or an RTU, remote terminal unit. So older control systems typically have PLCs, and newer ones typically have RTUs. And RTUs are a little bit more advanced, typically can handle wireless communication, which PLCs cannot. And a cyber-physical system, that's just a control system that is connected. And many old control systems were not designed to be connected to the outer world. So the security model was for something, you know, an air-gapped control system that has no connection to the outside world, but then has been, retrofitted with the connection. So that might break the security model that from the original design. An ICS, that's an industrial control system. So most control systems are ICS, industrial control systems. It's not common to see control systems outside industrial applications. And here also power plants and stuff like that are considered industrial control systems. In these control systems, it's a common terminology to segment the network to at least two parts, most often more than two parts. But the two main parts are the office network, that's called the IT network, and then the OT network, the operational technology network, and that is where all the control system stuff is located, and the physical stuff, and the RTUs, PLCs, the log server, that is usually called the data historian, and all that stuff is on the OT network. Oh, I didn't go to full screen. So why should we do ethical hacking? Yeah, the idea is that to protect critical infrastructure and find vulnerabilities before the real attackers, the bad guys, find the vulnerabilities and actually take over the plant or whatever. And critical infrastructure, that is things that keep society going, like power, electrical power plants, power grid, water purification plants, and stuff like that. The most famous attack on a critical infrastructure was Stuxnet, and for years the industry was only talking about Stuxnet, and It's starting to get a little bit old. Maybe you've heard of Bitcoin. Well, when the Stuxnet attack was carried out, Bitcoin wasn't used yet. So that was before Bitcoin. That is how old this is. So after Stuxnet, industry has been like waiting and expecting a new cyber 9/11 event, but it hasn't really happened yet. But some smaller events have happened, like for instance this one. This resulted in a power outage in Ukraine, December 2015, but the power outage only lasted a couple of hours. Then the power was back on, so that cannot really count as a cyber 9/11 event. Anyway, this is an example of how an actual attack can be carried out. So the attack starts with the malicious actors. Collect email addresses to people who work in this box, the corporate network, then send spear phishing mails to these email addresses, and one of them clicked on the evil link, and the RAT, the remote access Trojan, was installed. And in this case, the remote access Trojan was called Black Energy 3. Then the attacker started to do recon and enumeration to find IP addresses, services, and they found this one, which is what I told you about before, the domain controller where the credentials are stored. Or actually it says AD server here, but maybe it was on the same computer. They extracted the credentials and then used the credentials to access the corporate network the legitimate way through the encrypted tunnel here. Maybe it was a VPN tunnel. So what's the next step? Yes, there was a misconfiguration in the firewall here between the corporate network and the control center, which had the SCADA network. So the attackers were able to go from this network over to this network and access the HMI here. And they took over this computer and were actually able to control the mouse pointer on the screen here on the HMI. And with the mouse pointer, they could just click on the screen to turn off the power, 0.6 power outage. And at the same time, other malicious actors in the same attack group flooded the call center with telephone calls so that the legitimate callers who were affected by the power outage couldn't reach the support lines because all the support lines were taken by the malicious actors. So that was a little bit fun, called TDoS, or telephony-based denial of service. Then they shut down the UPS so they wouldn't have power to start do a forensics investigation. As a consequence of the power outage and the backup UPS interruption, the firmware on the port server here and the HMI, maybe that the HMI 2, was corrupted. But it is not clear. The investigators don't know if the corruption of the firmware was intentional or not. And the kill disk malware was used to wipe the computers here, these computers that were used for pivoting. Pivoting is the term for moving, doing lateral movement from one network to another. So they cleared those, they cleared the HMI, and so on, to make it harder to do forensics investigation afterwards. But the power was not out for very long. But another event in August 2003 in northeastern America, actually there was a bigger power outage. Now I don't remember what was the reason, the root cause for this power outage, but usually the most common reason for power outages or brownouts in general are squirrels. Yeah, they can get in everywhere. And when they get in, they get fried and the power goes out. So that's the most common. So maybe this blackout 2003 was a result of that. But researchers have studied what happened after this electrical power outage. So of course, inside houses, it was cold, but not very cold, because it's still August. It's not very cold in August. It had been worse if it was in, let's say, February. Okay, it's cold inside. The train stopped immediately because they run on power. And flights stopped. Air traffic stopped because airplanes use, you know, what's it, photogene or what it's called, kerosene. So they are not dependent on electricity, but other stuff that they require, that they depend on, use electricity, like air traffic control, the air traffic control tower, the security controls, booking systems, and so on. So it was still not possible to continue flights without electricity. Cars, yeah, they work, as you can expect, until they run out of fuel, but it's not possible to fill up new gas in the gas station because the pumps need electricity. Also, trucks stop, so the trains already stopped before, and after a while trucks stop, and you won't be able to transport anything. So that's not very good, because after a few weeks without any transports, things will start to get not so good. And even worse, water supply. Yeah, it's usually clean water is pumped up into a water tower, and then the natural force of the height difference of the water from the water tower to the ground, it keeps the water lines pressured. But when the level of water in the water tower drops, yeah, the lines lose pressure and dirty water starts leaking in, and then the clean water is not clean anymore. Bad news. But if you have your own pump that pumps up water from the ground, I don't know what's it called in English. In Swedish it's called groundwater, from maybe 20, 30, 50 meters down, then you can still be able to get water if that pump doesn't require electricity. If you have a hand-driven pump, then you can get water. Hospitals work, yeah, until the diesel reserves run out, which is usually 1 to 2 days. Then hospitals stop working too. The internet stops immediately. Mobile phone network actually works for a few hours, but after a while the base transceiver stations backup power runs dry, and then the mobile phone network is also down. Electronic payments, of course, don't work, and cash, yeah, cash works, but fewer and fewer stores actually accept cash nowadays, and people have less and less cash at home. So this will not work for long. And of course, things like medicines, food, well, they can neither be transported nor sold. So this will be a big problem very soon, or already after a week or two, this will start to get really bad. And also the economic consequences, you can only imagine what they will be. And the groups that can do this kind of attacks, they are usually called APT groups. That stands for Advanced Persistent Threat. And an APT group that is an actor with significant resources. For instance, an actor with the resources of a nation state behind them. So if you can see, those that are listed here are like from China, Russia, Vietnam, Iran, North Korea. And yeah, I think that's it. And the most famous ones, the ones that did this attack on the energy station, that's called the Sandworm Team. And there is actually a book by, I think, Andy Greenberg from Wired magazine. He wrote an entire book about this attack. And the book is just called Sandworm. And this team is also called Voodoo Bear. But the most famous team is APT-28 or Fancy Bear. And they did a lot of things, but mostly industry espionage. For instance, they are suspected of spying on vaccine companies like Pfizer and Astra and extracting information from their labs that they then sent on to their own people that made their own vaccine faster than the competition. And there are a lot of other groups, of course, and this group is also very famous, Lazarus Group, and they didn't do anything advanced. They actually only did these ransomwares like WannaCry, but they caused more damage. These ransomwares caused more economic damage than all the other APT groups together. And if you study the counters, you can see these are typically enemies of the United States, but there must be other APT groups, right? And, well, these two are the only ones, the other ones that are known. It's one from Israel and one from the United States. And the information about this group leaked out with Edward Snowden. And this was known a little bit about this, but when people started investigating Stuxnet, more information about this unit 8200 came out. So in Stuxnet, I think it was like this, that the Equation Group wrote the malware code. Unit 8200 did things like physical breaks in to steal certificates that were then used to sign the Stuxnet malware so it could be installed on Windows computers without any warnings, because it was it looked like the legitimate signed software. Also Equation Group did Flame, and Unit 8200 did Duke malware. And there is not as much known about Duke and Flame, but Stuxnet is pretty well studied. And then it's a question mark. Of course, there are more APT groups, but they are just simply not known. In Sweden, there has recently been an effort to extend the military with a cyber defense division. So that's called the CDIS. I think it's Cyber Defense Information Security Center. And this is the same guy that is a teacher in this course, Ethical Hacking, that is also a teacher over there. Here, it starts begin a little bit political. This is the Tallinn Manual. It's an effort to extend the international law into the cyber domain. The old international law, it's many, many, what do you call it, agreements that are signed between nations, like the Geneva Conventions, and there's this Helsinki Agreement from 1975 about the inviolability of borders, and most importantly, the principle of territorial integrity. And the nations of, mostly Europe, have been working towards this since the time of Napoleon. And now we have come to a state that the territorial integrity is accepted. So a violation of territorial integrity, then this territorial integrity part of international law says it is okay to retaliate, but the retaliation or the response must be, what do you call it? It must not be worse than the violation of the territorial integrity was in the first place. So the response must be proportional. I think that is the word they use. So if you extend this into the cyber domain, well, if you are attacked by a cyber attack as a nation, well, then the nation can respond, but the response must be proportional. That's about what it says. And then I wrote this third, this is just my own thoughts. If you look here, this was taken or proposed by the NATO Cooperative Cyber Defense Center of Excellence in the Balticum somewhere. And if you go back and look at the APT teams, none of these countries where the APT groups are from were involved. So I think it's naive to think that these APT countries will sign an agreement that is based on this, but I think you have to involve them too. You have to involve China and so on before you can get an agreement that is widely accepted internationally. Then there is this about attribution. So attribution is the process of determining who is making the violation against you. If there is a, let's say, 50 Mexican soldiers walks over the border into the United States, then attribution, that is the part of finding out where are these soldiers from. Well, they are from Mexico, and that's the attribution. But in the case of a cyber attack, it's harder, because the attacker might try to hide their electronic footprints, or even make it look like it was someone else who did the attack. Maybe Israel did the attack, but they want to make it look like it was Iran that did the attack. So in the cyber attack scenario, attribution is much harder. But as he said, the teacher, it's not impossible if the people who does the forensics investigation after the attack also has the resources of a nation state, then it might be possible to do attribution. And after the attribution is done, well, then the response should be, like I said, proportional. It must not be extremes. It cannot be 10 times worse than the violation was in the first place. Okay, so now, what can the ethical hacker do? Yeah, as I said, the ethical hacker or the penetration tester can try to find vulnerabilities in the systems before the real attacker finds them. So the people who owns the factory have a chance, or the plant have a chance to fix the vulnerabilities before the attacker comes. So it was a number of things that we were taught in the course, and it was like I explained, finding IP addresses, services, vulnerabilities and services, exploit those services, and extract information like password files and other informations. That were the information that gave points in the course were called flags, like in the usual capture the flag competitions. And we also needed to move from system to system and subnet to subnet to reach all the flags. And this was not part in the course I took, but there is another similar course with the same name, but with another course number, that where this is also a part of the course. And know what is allowed by the law, so you don't break the law when you do your penetration testing. So we learned by connecting to the KTH cyber range, which is was located in the Google Cloud, and there they put up a number of virtual machines in Google Cloud in a segmented network, and they planted some known vulnerabilities on these machines, and then it was up to us, the students, to find those vulnerabilities and extract the flags. So typically, like I said, find vulnerable services, exploit them. Maybe become a normal user, maybe try to do privilege escalation, become the administrative user, and then it is possible to reach the next network or the next computer, and then repeat the same process again. And then there was a lot of readings and some educational videos in the course. Yeah, and then there was this quiz on the law. So the readings were divided into these categories: Linux, Windows, networking, virtualization, assembly, web, cloud, encoding, encryption and hashing, wireless network, and the law. And as you can see, this is a lot of information. Usually there is an entire course just learning Linux, an entire course just learning networking. So this is a gigantic course, knowledge-wise. But luckily enough, I knew a lot of this. I knew Linux, I knew networking, I knew assembly, I knew encoding, encryption and hashing, and wireless networks. So the new, for me, what was new was Windows. Virtualization was not much, it was just getting Kali Linux up in a virtual machine, that was all. So the new thing was Windows, and I know some web, but not very much. But what I knew was actually enough to take the flags. So the new things I had to learn was Windows, cloud, and the law. And I spent most time reading about the Google Cloud. Here are some of the tools. I used all these tools except the Burp Suite. This is a proxy between the web client and the web server, and you can intercept requests from the web client, and you can intercept responses from the web server and investigate them, and you can even change them and send again and do resends. So typically you can, if you find an API, you can try to change all the different stuff in the API here. But I didn't need it in this course. SQL map, if you have a web page with an SQL backend, SQL map can try to find SQL injection vulnerabilities. Hashcat can be used to crack password hashes, and you can also use a tool like John the Ripper. And Metasploit was the tool I used most in this course to find the flags. So it has a lot of plugins, and most of the flags in this course had a Metasploit module that worked. And I don't have access to the cyber range anymore, but I'm going to do a demo after the slides, and in the demo I'm going to connect with Metasploit to the metasploitable virtual machine, just to demonstrate how it works. Nmap can be used to find IP addresses, services, open ports and stuff like that. Wireshark, of course, I think everybody used it to inspect network traffic and packets. Mimikatz can be used to extract credentials from Windows networks. Nessus, basically does the same as Nmap, but it presents it in a nice way, and it also knows about vulnerabilities in different services. And it also has tests for if the vulnerabilities are there or not. And then you get a report, and if you click on the vulnerability in the report, you see the name of the Metasploit module. And also similar tools like Metasploit, it also prints the name of the module in those other applications. Hydra uses a word list of users and a word list of passwords, and then tries to log in with all usernames and passwords. And it supports protocols like FTP, Telnet, SSH, and web login. Basic authentication, I think it's called. I think it supports more protocols too. And this is of course used for wireless to crack WPA2, and there are like a million tutorials online for how to do this with AirCrack NG. So that was actually pretty easy. And cyber law was a quiz, and the law text was not very simple to understand. So I think it was hard answering the quiz the first time, but luckily enough, you can take the quiz as many times you want, and after you take it the first time, after each question, you get a long text explaining exactly what laws are applicable, and it even says which question is the correct answer and why, and refers to the relevant sections of the law. So after taking the quiz first time and examining the text, which was written by a law firm, you can be able to answer the questions correctly the second time, even if the original law text is very confusing. So after the introductory lecture, you get VPN credentials and connect to the cyber range and start looking for flags. So here's, for instance, one part of the Swedish criminal code, or Brottsbalken in Swedish, chapter 4, paragraph 9c. So it says, a person who unlawfully obtains access to information intended for automatic processing, whatever that means, or unlawfully alters, erases, blocks, or in a register inserts such information, typically a database, is guilty of breach of data security and is sentenced to a fine of imprisonment for at most 2 years. And then it continues and says, if it's a gross breach of data security, the max sentence, I think it was 6 years. But this is not very clear, I think, this text. So from this text, you are supposed to be able to answer questions like this. As part of your legitimate work, you accidentally directed a denial of service attack on the KTH web servers. You realize your mistake after a few seconds, but then realize it will be fun to see what happens if the attack continues. Which one of the following are true? Looking at this text says almost nothing about how to answer this question. So, but the feedback here you get after taking the quiz for the first time, here it is explained how the law text is interpreted by lawyers. So I think it's almost necessary to take the quiz one time and then read this feedback text, and then you can understand how to answer the questions correctly the second time you take the quiz. Yeah, in this case, it was the legal for the first second when you didn't realize that you had caused a denial of service attack, but it became illegal when you decided to let it continue. Yeah, and why? Yeah, it was because when you decided to let it continue, you had intent. But in the first few seconds, you had no bad intent. So that's the difference. Yeah, and that's a similar one. And there's here are some other laws. But because the law text is a little bit confusing, it's not easy to know if you are acting within the frames of the law. So it's a kind of a balance act. But the most important thing to keep in mind seems to be to have good intent. Yeah. And I can say a little bit about this word, ethical. So it's actually two parts necessary to be able to act within the law. The first, it's called morals. And morals in this context means to know what the law says. And the ethics here, it means following what you think the law says. So if you don't know what the law says, then you don't know what to follow. So you can still follow what you believe, but what you believe is wrong, well, then you have bad morals but good ethics. But to be able to act within the law, you have must both know the law and act within the law. So you must have both good morals and good ethics. So that's the philosophical difference between those two words. And lastly, pivoting. Let's say I'm at this iMac. I can access this Linux box, but I cannot access this Windows box over here. So what do I do? Well, I do what I can to this Linux box. And if I can take over it, then maybe from this Linux box, I can access this Windows box. So as you can see here, maybe this is the IT network, and over here, maybe here is the OT network in a different subnet, and the Windows is maybe even the HMI. So if I can take over these two, then maybe I can control the mouse and actually click in the HMI of the control system. So that was all the slides, and now over to the demo. Okay, I have to start my... I'm going to run in a Docker metasploit. So this sets environment variables and this starts metasploit. Maybe I can run git pull first. No, not git pull. It's Docker pull. It's already late. Just start it. And then this Windows machine, I'm actually logged into it. It has a tendency to go into hibernation or something if I don't do anything. So I'm logged in through SSH here to the Windows machine just so it doesn't die. I brought up the virtual machines of metasploitable using something called Vagrant, which I downloaded the Vagrant file from the metasploitable webpage. So it runs an Ubuntu 14.04 box with some known vulnerabilities, which they have, this Rapid7 have planted into this Ubuntu, and a Windows 2008 box with also some vulnerabilities. And there is an environment variable. If MS3 difficulty is set to easy, then the firewall is disabled. Otherwise, if it's not set to easy when running Vagrant up, well, then it will enable the firewall and it will be more difficult to access the Windows machine. But I already ran Vagrant up, and if you see what it says, well, I think you could already see in the Vagrant file, there is a username Vagrant, password Vagrant, but this is, we are not going to use the username Vagrant, password Vagrant, because that is the back door in. So what we are going to do is practice Metasploit without using the Vagrant account. Okay, now that's started. Now I'm in the Metasploit Docker. I can try to find my IP address. But it's a very minimal Docker. I don't even have ifconfig, so I can... I wrote down a little cheating note with some commands here. I can use this awk command to find the IP address. So these addresses are seen by the Docker, and if I look at IP addresses, I see this is the network of the metasploitable virtual machines 172 blah 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 slash 24, and this is the Docker 192.168.99.1/24, and if we see here, only one address is this one, is in that subnet. So this is the IP address of the Metasploit Docker machine. So I start MSF console. That's a Metasploit framework console. Well, while that starts, I can do some scanning. So I'm going to scan the metasploitable, do a ping scan, and see which IP address is up. And I see .3 is up, and I think that is the Linux box, and .14 is up, and I think that is the Windows box. Or I know it because I'm already logged in to the Windows box here. What do we write in Windows? It's ipconfig, I think. Mm-hmm. It's not the best shell in the world, not even Backspace works. .14 here. Anyway, I'm already cheating. I'm not supposed to know these things. I'm only supposed to get it from Nmap. So that's the Linux machine. Let's scan a little bit closer on that one. Okay. Nmap-F only scans the 100 most popular ports. If you don't write that F, it's going to scan the 1000 most popular ports. And you can also specify port range to scan. For instance, maybe I want to scan between port 8000 and 9000, and then I can do that. And maybe I will find more ports open. But let's start with... I can start with FTP first. There, to scan only port 21, but do a little more thorough scan, I can add some parameters on the command line, scsv. Now I only check port 21, and I see the version. It's ProFTPD version 135, all right? So here in I have exploit database, I cloned it from GitHub. You can do git pull to get the latest exploits. And I got some new exploits, and I run this search exploit script to search for exploits. I want to search for pro FTPD exploits. And you can see 135, and I'm going to use Metasploit. This one seems to work in Metasploit. It's ProFTPD 135, something with mod copy. And here I can also see the source code, but I don't need to know that. I only need to search for this exploit in Metasploit. All right, so it seems my Metasploit crashed. No, maybe that was just... okay, that's just a joke when it started up. Search. Well, first you set G almost all Metasploit modules wants the rhosts variable to be set, so I run set g with the IP address of the Linux machine, so this will automatically set whichever module I go into. I search for pro ftpd and I will find this one for 135. It has rate excellent, that is promising, and it's mod copy, same as searchploit said. And in reality, you will not have this much luck so often, but because this is metasploitable, there will be one metasploit module for almost every service that will work. Show options shows the options, and as you can see, this was automatically set to the correct one. This is correct. It uses both the FTP port and the HTTP port, but it needs a path with a writable directory, and this is not writable. I already tried it before I started recording, so I'm going to set that to var.html, and that one is writable. Yeah, and I think the rest is correct, but I have to set a payload. I can search for payloads here, and this one is pretty stable. Perl is an excellent programming language, and it's just rock solid, the reverse shell over here. I can explain. If run bind payload, it will bind a port on the exploited machine, and then I will have to connect from my metasploit machine to the exploited machine. But if there's a firewall in between, that traffic might be stopped. So it's easily to go through, more easy to go through the firewall if I do a reverse connection, so that the target, the attacked target machine, connects back to my metasploit. And those payloads are called reversed and something. Aha. And you can see I have to set the lhost variable, that is the IP address of my metasploit, and that is, if you remember, 99.100. And I have to specify a port number on my metasploit machine that is available, and right now I haven't done anything, so all ports are available. So I'm just gonna go with the default. Run the exploit, see if it worked, and it worked, I got the shell. But now, this is not the best shell in the world. For instance, if I write cd, I'm in var.html, cd dot dot. I'm still in var.html because the shell restarts for each command. So I want to do something better. Here, upgrading simple shells to fully interactive T2Is. So there are a number of different ways to do this. When you have this rudimentary shell, kind of not working shell. So this is the simplest. If Python is installed, I can use the pty module to spawn a bash process. This is on the Linux machine. And Python was installed, and I got a little bit better shell. Can look at the processes and see I'm hanging on this. This is my reverse Perl exploit. And this was launched by this PHP thing. Changing directory. And now I can change directories after I upgraded the shell. In the password file, I can see usernames. I already know that Vagrant, this is the backup account, and we're not going to use that one. But I have here normal users. I think it's these ones. So it's Leia Organa and so on. And I want to see, but I don't see their password hashes because those are in shadow and I don't have permission. I am just running as www.data. But I can check the group file. So here I see something interesting. The users in the sudo group can of course use sudo to just to be root. Especially if sudo is configured to run without password, then you don't even have to specify the password. And here, that seems a little bit strange, but there are a number of users in the Docker group, so now I'm going to investigate why. Let's see if there is some process running with one of these users that we can exploit. Okay, there was one user, I think they cut the username. It's opt unreal irk, it's the IRC daemon unreal version 3.2. That runs as user Boba Fett. So if we can exploit this, we will become user Boba Fett and be in the Docker group. So let's try to do that. I can background this shell. Or I can even exit it because I know everything I want to know now. Search Unreal. So here there is an Unreal Irk Daemon 3.2 something. With rank excellent, that was unusually good luck, don't you think? Well, this is metasploitable after all, and we will constantly have good luck. So that was correctly set, but that port is not open, I think. So let's see if we can find another IRC port. I want to scan port range from this port to maybe this port and see which ports are open. So it seems to take a while. And this port range was pretty small. Then imagine scanning a larger port range. Okay, I found one. 6697. Maybe I can do a little bit of investigation there. So it found out it was Unreal Irk there. Yeah, and some more information which is not useful for exploitation, but this seems to be the port to set as R port. And the payload. Let's go with a reverse Perl again. Set payload. L port. Okay, L port 4444 cannot be used because, or actually I closed that session, but I'm just to be sure I'm going to use another port. And L host. There. I wonder if I can set this globally, so it will be automatically set. Now I think everything that needs to be set is set. All right, and I got a shell as Boba Fett. Let's upgrade that shell using the same technique as before, the Python. You can also use, for instance, how the other things listed here, netcat or esocat, even better. But this is enough for my purposes. Because this is not a perfect shell. For instance, I write ls and then up arrow don't work. But I can change directory, that's most important. There is no SSH directory. I can try to create an SSH directory and upload a key for a key pair. It was created with the correct permission. RWX SSH refuses to use the key if you have RWX, RWX, RWX on this directory. and it wants the key in a file called authorized keys. I don't need this, I just need this. This is the key. So echo, oh, I can't go back. I'm gonna start from the beginning. So I don't think it is necessary to have, but it will work with this permission. So now I can actually try to log in as Boba Fett. I don't know the password for Boba Fett, but I can try to log in as Boba Fett, and it was possible to log in without a password. I don't need this anymore. Now I have an actual shell. So there's my now up arrow will work because I'm logged in with the usual SSH. So now I have a good. Yeah, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm going to do a lean enum, that local enumeration that looks for privilege escalation problems. And the raw link to it is this. Okay, I have connection to the outside world, so I can just wget installed. I'm in luck. So around this, maybe I can save the output. So now this shell script is running and looking for problems with the configuration of this Linux box. It has some escape characters, but maybe less minus arrow. Yeah, that worked. So it has print some information. It's 1404. We already knew that. Host name. We already knew that. Maybe some of the SUID files also can be exploited. This is my own bash history. Yeah, I know, I wrote that. Okay, looks like we're hosting Docker. We're a member of the Docker group, could possibly misuse these rights. Okay, so it actually warned about this, that I'm going to use now. So I just googled the commands. I'm going to build a Docker container. It's not very much, but I don't remember it in head. So the Docker container is going to be based on Alpine, and I'm going to supply two files, root.sh and root shell. And then when the Docker is run, hopefully root shell will be installed as suid root. And actually the root.sh shell script will make sure that root shell is changed of permission to suid root when the Alpine image is started. So I'm going to create that. Here, it just schmods the permissions to suid root. And now I have to create a root shell binary from, well, I must have a compiler installed. And we're in luck again, we have a compiler. And this C file, it set user ID 0 and spawns a shell. I could change this to bash if I want a better shell. But bash leaves more electronic footprints than sh. Compile it. Okay, now we're ready to build the image. So it's going to use a regular vanilla Alpine and add these two files. Now it's downloading Alpine from the internet. Done. Now I'm going to launch it and say to mount /tmp/persist on and after it's launched, I'm going to execute root.sh that changes permissions of root shell. And that's it. Yeah, okay, it only runs this root.sh, and then the root shell will be left in /tmp/persist. So now the Docker has run and it has finished. But here we have a suidroot root binary. Done. We are now root without having used the vagrant username credentials. All right. Here are the password hashes. And also this is vagrant. We already know that. That was the backdoor account. So we could copy this. Just for fun. VI Linux. There. All right, so the Windows machine had 12. No, it had 14 at the end. 14. Yeah, it's up. I'm going to do a fast scan to check the 100 most common ports. It also has an FTP. It has a MySQL. Let's try that first. Yeah, it had the admin, the root user, didn't have a password set. So you can log in without a password. So it's a WordPress database in here. Can use that. And the credentials are stored in the WP users table. And we are only interested in the username and the user pass. Maybe you would, in a real case, also save the mail, but I'm only going to select those two. User login and user pass. So here is the credentials for WordPress. That's the phpass algorithm. So let's do a single John again. Save it in john.pot, the results. A single mode. And I got two, I got vagrant and manager. There are two more. And I actually did this before, so I know the password. And I know that the password is in the word list. It's on a dict sec list by Daniel Miesler, passwords, and the open wall word list. Okay, I'm going to try 1,000 ports in this range and on the Windows machine and see if there's still no cracks over here. I've gone through how many percent of the word list? 6% of the word list. Here I found one open port and I can actually try to access that port with my web browser. The IP address was 14 at the end. And here I can see it's in a Jenkins installation directly here in the slash path. It's no subpath, okay? So I can try to, while that is working, I can close that one. Go back to this, search Jenkins. So there are numbers here, and I tried a few without luck, for instance this one. And then I searched online for metasploitable 3 and I found out, oh, it's this module that works, okay? And it's not ranked excellent, it's just ranked good, but this one works. Okay. Lhost is wrong. Our port is wrong. 484. Target URI is wrong. It was just slash directly. The other ones are not necessary. No, no, no. Not necessary. Da, da, da. Target is Windows. Yeah, maybe that's all it takes. Let's try it. I don't know if I forgot something. So this is more normal. Usually this is how it works. Yeah, the R host is wrong. It should be 14. I can actually set that globally. 14. All right. Now something happens. It uploads a payload. When this payload is uploaded, it will try to reverse to port 4444. I hope that one is closed by now, because I closed the session that was associated with port 4444. Yeah, it worked. Now I have a metarpreter shell. So I can do some things with the metarpreter shell. For instance, get system to attempt to elevate privileges. But it didn't work. So then I'm 100% sure hash dump will not work either. Yeah, so we need to find some other way to elevate privileges. Yeah, this will take forever. So I'm just going to use the Vagrant backup account now. Ah, okay, here's the WordPress. Now it cracked that. So we have the user admin has the password sploit. So if I wanted, I could log into the WordPress installation with admin rights and this password. All right. But I am going to upload Mimikatz to the Vagrant backup, just to show how it looks. And it's a 64-bit Windows. So in real life, I shouldn't use the Vagrant backup account. I should try to elevate my privileges. But I think this video is long enough now. Vagrant, nope. I didn't supply the username, Vagrant. And log in with SSH. Run Mimikatz. Okay, and then there is privilege : debug to raise privilege. And now it worked. I actually tried this with the Jenkins account, which I exploited first. And then privilege debug did not work, but with the Vagrant account it works. So I'm going to just search from some Mimikatz tutorial. So LSA dump SAM dumps password hashes. And it didn't work. So I can try something to elevate my privileges. Maybe that token elevate. And then try to dump again. Now it worked. So now we have the Windows password hashes for the same users as on the Linux box, and with a little luck, with a little luck. They have the same password on the Linux box and the Windows box. Okay, there you have it. So let's run John again. Okay. So administrator vagrant protocol zero. I can try to add some okay, just do the same, it would be fast. Rocky. It found the same ones. Let's try the best 64 rules. It's the same in Hashcat and John. The best 64 rules. That was actually a result of a competition. I think I had another dictionary with the usernames, with all usernames. I think this is a little bit cheating because I did a longer crack and extracted these words. And best 64 rules. Just so you see, it's kind of repetitive. Got and one rule to rule them all. So now I have 14 out of 17, and I'm going to do this. I'm going to run Hashcat in standard out mode. Just give it the word list and this, so it will just write the rules to standard out. Then I'm going to unique them, so there's no duplicates. It's in the John Ripper directory, and the word list with one rule to rule them all rule applied. Okay, so now I have 1.4 million words. I'm going to use that word list. That won't give anything, because I already tried this. But I can try this with the best 64 rules. And I got a few more, and now I have 16 out of 17. You could go on and on and on, but this is a basic how you actually do the ethical hacking course. These are the kind of activities you do to take the flags. I think I'm going to stop now.